Hey there, everyone. Welcome or welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Now, last Friday, I promised you another story from someone named Ophelia, who wrote in a couple months ago with a story that, well, quite frankly, blew most of you away. Most of you were halfway through the story before you realized it was being told from the viewpoint of a young female Sasquatch. So needless to say, that story was fiction. But it was the good kind of fiction, the kind that left most of you wanting more. Well, tonight, Ophelia is giving us more. So if you're one of those who really hates anything that is not a God's honest true story, well, go ahead and just skip out of here right now. Go on, I'll wait. All right, for the rest of you, if you're still with me, awesome. I'm really going to try to save all my chit-chat for the back end of this video, and I do have a fair amount of chit-chat, and I'm going to do then. But for right now, it's time to get on up in the saddle. We're going to head straight down into Sasquatch Valley, and tonight, the uncle from the young female in the earlier story a couple months ago, well, they're going to travel to meet us there in the dark heart of Sasquatch Valley. He's going to tell us further stories from the view of one of those who lives there and around the Sasquatch Valley. Are you ready? Me too. Let's go. Hello to you, Nance, and to the Sasquad. I wanted to say hello and thank you for all the kind comments you left after Nance told you the story of my tribe. Let me make a proper introduction. I am Uncle from my niece's recounting of her first encounter with humans. Nance told our story to all of you a few months back. First things first, I'll start with my name. In our language, it means of the earth. But more specific than that, like a particular quality of a particular kind of earth. That's the thing about trying to learn your words. You have so many of them, and we have so few. Yet each of our words can mean a whole range of different things, depending on how we say it. You would call it tone of voice. So my name means a specific kind of earth, like a rock, but not exactly. Or many rocks, like Rocky. Yes, I like that. You can call me Rocky. My niece's name means flower, or more accurately, the kind with the bright yellow petals, with the dark center which grows everywhere and anywhere because they are so hardy. I think you call them black-eyed Susies. It suits her because, well, she's beautiful. She has dark eyes and she can survive anywhere. So you can call her Susie. We are not given names at birth. First, we are called things like kit or pup or fawn until our personalities develop, and then our names are given to us by the whole tribe. Well, where was I? I'm sorry, you have to forgive me. I'm an old Sasquatch now. Now, Susie didn't mention just how long ago all of that she told you happened, but it was a long, long time ago. Susie herself will be a grandmother any day now. But back then, back on that day, the day I saw that little family, the encounter that changed everything, well, back then, I was in my prime. I was something to see, if I do say so myself. I was taller and broader than almost anyone I knew, and I could lift a full-grown cow over my shoulders. No one tangled with me. Well, no one who was able to tell the story afterwards, anyway. But I was also a different Sasquatch back then. I know you understand why. Susie did a great job at explaining everything. I still regret a few of the things I did before that day. When she said that the trail that ran up the other side of our mountain was seldom used, well, there was a reason for that. Especially considering, and I may be a bit biased in this, but considering the view from the top of our mountain is awe-inspiring, no matter what species you are. For a while, that trail wasn't very safe for humans. These days, I'm pleased to say that humans are exceptionally safe on that trail, and it has become very popular. In fact, years after the incident, I saw the boy from our encounter again. But that tale's a long one, so I'll save that for some other time. In fact, there has never been a bear encounter, a lost hiker, or a misplaced child since that day. Although I'd be lying if I were to say it's because I suddenly became the protector of all humans. No, the fact is, a lost person would bring hordes of humans swarming our territory, and that would mean danger of our home being discovered. At least, that's how I explain my defense of humans to other Sasquatch. Either way, it's best for everyone that the humans leave our area safe and sound. But before my change in perspective, I made sure that humans did not come near our tribe. But those are events I'd really rather forget, as I am ashamed of how I was back then. After Nance told our encounter, the Sasquatch had such lovely things to say. I wasn't sure how they would react to hearing our side of things. That's why I was so hesitant. I didn't want to do it, but Susie pestered me so much. I told her she could tell our story if she wanted, but I didn't want to get involved. However, hearing all the nice things people said has changed my mind. Many of you asked to hear more of our kind's perspective, and I'm happy to oblige. The Sasquatch has taught me that understanding each other, well, that would go a long way to peacefully coexisting. Some asked to hear the whole story of my flight between where my tribe was killed and finding my father's family. I started out to relay that journey to all of you, but I find myself reluctant to do so. It's such a sad and lonely story, full of fear and sadness. I can tell it if you want, but Susie did such a good job hitting the important bits. How about instead I tell you a couple of stories about my family? The stories, they cross over with my journey, so I hope that will suffice. Besides, it's nice to talk about the ones that I lost that day. It helps keep their memory alive. You will be happy to know that my aunt and her two daughters, the ones who managed to escape into the deep woods just as the attack started, well, they are alive and thriving. In fact, my aunt is the alpha female of Nance's Sasquatch Valley. Oh, Nance didn't tell you all that, did she? Well, she didn't tell you that she's known my family for many, many years? Well, that's how we met, through my aunt. We don't just let anyone come into Sasquatch Valley, you know. Nance was carefully vetted for years, and now has been allowed free rein to come into our territory. To be clear, we only discourage unwelcome visitors who wander onto our land. We just gently move the humans along, nowadays anyway. But Nance refused to be quietly moved along, so my aunt befriended her instead. She really didn't tell you all any of this. Well, actually, if I think about it, I'm not at all surprised. Nance kept her promise. She swore to never tell a living soul about us or where we live. I know many of you Sasquatch have been allowed to run all over the valley if you are with Nance. So she must like you all an awful lot. She's pretty picky about humans for obvious reasons. But given how many humans my aunt now associates with these days, she needed a name that people could understand. Her real name is unpronounceable to humans, although it's pretty funny to hear you try. Directly translated, my aunt's name means Mother Earth, but that in no way matches the true meaning. For you, Mother Earth is a separate entity, an individual who nurtures and provides in one moment and then is cruel and merciless the next. We do not see nature as a separate entity from ourselves, nor do we see it as a single consciousness. Humans do have some odd notions. After the day Susie and I stumbled on those hikers, I had a bit of a crisis of conscience. I embarked on a lifelong study of humans. I would watch them every chance I got. When we needed a name for my aunt, all I could think of was this one time that I spent the day watching two young men out hunting. They were walking along, talking. I had picked up a lot of your words by then, and I could understand them pretty well. But I was still confused by how people act and why they do the things they do, and I took every chance I could to learn in hopes to understand human behavior. These two men seemed to be discussing a young woman they wished to court. They were making up poetry that exalted her virtues. Now this I understood. We don't write poetry when we are courting a female, but we do have our ways of showing a girl that we appreciate her attributes, and this seemed no different. From what I could make out, the maiden in question was much sought after for her many outstanding qualities. These men were making up a poetry they called a limerick, presumably to recite to the young woman in hopes of wooing her. Although, truth be told, having seen more than a few other human males by then, well, these two, they didn't seem to have much going for them. Maybe that's why they were working so hard to get the limericks just right. It was probably their only hope to gain her favor. Courting rituals seem to be something almost all species do, although those rituals differ dramatically. But I could relate to the particular qualities these humans wanted to find in a mate, so I was captivated. I was finally getting some insight into human males and their ways. They made verses about the young woman's physical beauty. She was said to possess an unusually tall stature and to be exceptionally wide of girth. They made up whole stanzas to her memories of near impossible size. These were sensible young men, I thought. You need a strong mate to bear children, to survive childbirth, feed a hungry infant, and then that mate would need to protect those children when the male was off hunting. No wonder she was so sought after. Well, we Sasquatch value the same things. I started to think human men were more sensible than I first thought. They spoke about her facial hair, which was confusing, as I had not seen any human females with any sort of hair on their face. But it makes sense that they would want such a rare quality in a mate, in hopes that this highly sought-after feature would then be passed down to any offspring. Also, it was implied that she was keen on reproducing and had been advertising her eagerness to get on with the process. I approved. One must look for a willing mate. The young woman should be ready and willing to take on the responsibilities of a mate and family. Perhaps these men had more going for them than I first thought. They seemed to be going about things, well, very rationally. They then went on to explain her iron will and her fierce demeanor that was feared by all. By this point, I was half ready to go find this exceptional young maiden and court her myself. They were even kind enough to include her name and location in their poetry. Her name was Olga from Muskoka. Now, you may have heard of her, as I'm sure every young man for miles around had presented themselves for consideration. I doubt, though, that either of these young hunters had a chance. But nonetheless, I found myself rooting for them. Perhaps she picked one of them, although I expect not. But I do hope that she at least appreciated their poetry. They did work so diligently on it. So now we called my aunt Olga, as she is exceptionally large, and she is feared and respected by all. Even the alpha male will defer to her authority. Otherwise, he's likely to suffer the humiliation of receiving a sound beating, as most of her suitors from when she was a young maiden could attest. Well, the ones that survived, that is. We visit Olga at the place that you call Sasquatch Valley once in a while. We used to go once every couple of summers, but less so now as the distance gets longer and longer each time I go. Funny, when I was a young buck, it was such a quick trip. But somehow, many miles seem to have been added on to the trail. But it's still worth the trip when we do go. There aren't many left, though, who remember the ones who went back home to Mother Earth that day. It's nice to talk about them. That's why I agreed that Nance could start telling our stories. This way, we will be remembered. But enough pontificating from this old buck. I promised you a story. There were a handful of others that made it out alive on that horrible day that took my tribe from me. Aside from the little babies and the four-footed ones that you would call toddlers, they were captured by the soldiers. Well, beyond them, a few more made it out. Just by happenstance, many winters later, I did find out more about what happened to the little ones. But that, too, is a very long story, and one I don't care to recount right now. But maybe I will later, if you all wish to hear it. When we heard the danger coming, I was so upset that my parents wouldn't let me join the men to fight. It was especially painful because all of my cousins had been allowed to go with the men, and they were a mere few moons older than me, including my two best friends. We had done everything together since we were little and had just started to walk on all fours. To see them go with the men while I was left with the little ones was a sore blow. But as soon as the Iron Birds, which I now know are machines made by humans, as soon as they had filled the sky, the elders knew that things were dire. So the immediate decision was made, and the juveniles were ordered to run in hopes that they had time to make it deeper into the wilderness, where they stood a chance to get away. Sasquatch Young learned quickly to obey their parents and their elders instantly and without question. To disobey could mean injury or death, so the punishment for disobedience is swift and severe. But telling a Sasquatch to abandon their family to save themselves, well, that goes against everything we are. So many of them hesitated. That moment of hesitation, though, would have been worse if my cousin, Rolling Mountain, the biggest among us, hadn't surged forward as the first soldier landed on the ground. He flew at them viciously, and he took down many of them before he fell, as he took the full force and brunt of the fear and adrenaline from the soldiers. But it bought enough time for several of the young adolescents to get away, although it did take being pushed and shoved by their fathers and uncles to get them moving. After I watched my grandmother fall in defense of the little ones, and I watched these horrible men grab the helpless babies and shove them into sacks, I had fled with my baby sister, Strongest River. She was clutched in my arms. She was not going to be captured, and she wasn't. As most of you know, well, besides, if she had been, Susie wouldn't be here. The going, well, that was pretty rough at first. My sister was so traumatized, she wouldn't even hold on. All Sasquatch babies are born with the instinct to hold on to their mother. So I had to use one arm to hold her while trying to keep to the treetops. As soon as I dared, I stopped to get my bearings and to try to calm River down. I had barely begun to collect myself when I felt a familiar tremor in the trees, and my best friend Mole landed on the branch next to me. Mole was lean and lanky, completely opposite of how I was. But what he lacked in brute strength, he made up for in intelligence and cunning. He was especially skilled at getting into small spaces, cracks, crevices, and burrows. He could reach his long arms into a rabbit warren and come out with three in each hand before you could jump a log. His burrowing and digging quickly earned him the name Mole. The relief I felt when he appeared was immeasurable. Our other best friend, Bad Dog, well, he landed next to him a second later. How Bad Dog, or just Dog to us, got his name is also a bit of a story itself. Dog was always a dreamer and a thinker. He was a quick wit, always joking around, and he was up for any adventure, no matter how ill-advised. Sadly, he didn't possess the common sense of a mayfly. Consequently, he was always coming up with crazy, doomed ideas. They usually ended badly, but Dog was so happy and friendly, and everyone loved him. So the disasters he created, they were quickly forgiven, and mostly forgotten. But there was this one incident when a hunter and a dog wandered across our path. The details aren't important, but afterwards, Dog got it in his head that if humans could keep pet dogs, well, so could he. There was a wolf den nearby, and they had a new litter of pups. Wolves and Sasquatch, they tend to give each other a wide berth. The wolves are smart enough to keep away from the big hairy men, and we Sasquatch know that a large, angry wolf pack could be a nuisance if provoked. And since we don't eat them, and they can be dangerous to our young if angered, well, we just tend to leave them be. But Dog? No, Dog would not let the thought go. Everyone told him it was a bad idea, but he would not be convinced. He wanted one of those wolf pups to train to be his own pet. We all said wolves were not dogs. And then he argued that dogs were fine for people, but a Sasquatch needed a wolf. He would drag Mole and I with him as he tried to get close enough to snatch a pup. At first, the adult wolves stood protectively over the litter and would give a quiet warning growl. But as Dog got bolder, they started being more aggressive in defense. We were still very young. We had barely started walking upright, and the wolves could have easily killed us. But they knew better than to kill us and bring down the wrath of our parents. But finally, they had had enough, and they chased us all the way back to the adults. And that's the day Bad Dog got his name. Because the idea to make a pet was a bad one. Not because Dog himself was bad. It was just the idea. The day I realized the translation of his name and just how different the meaning was in human language, I had been watching a hiker and his dog for 3 days. On this day, the dog had run away from his master. Before that moment, the dog had obediently followed every command and had not strayed more than a few steps from the man's side. Even with all the smells of the wild, the dog would abandon even the choicest of scents at a word or command. Until the dog bolted into the brush to the dismay of his master, that is. The man chased the dog to a field where his companion was gleefully rolling in a decaying deer carcass. The man was screaming, "Bad dog! Bad dog!" over and over, alternating with, "Come, come here right now." The dog stopped for just a moment. He looked at the man expectantly. We Sasquatch don't need words to know exactly what another species is saying. It's only humans that seem to be handicapped by the language barrier. It was clear this dog was saying, "I can share. There's plenty of room." and the dog stood there graciously waiting for his beloved human to take the most prime spot in the middle of the filth. Now, the dog assumed the man was upset that he thought he was hogging the carcass. When the man continued to yell, the dog gave the man a look that said, "Well, if you don't want to join in, that's your loss." And the dog went back to rolling with delight through the offal. The dog clearly was having the time of his life. He has never imagined such divine ecstasy. He cast his human a guilty look and then continued to wriggle on his back through the rotting remains. This was the best day of that dog's life ever. The man had just grabbed the dog's collar when I worked out the translation. Bad dog. Ha, ha, ha. Well, unlike Olga's name in translation, bad dogs was even more fitting and suited him even better. Well, from my perspective anyway, dog might disagree. I was overcome by the humor of it, and I started to laugh out loud. I just couldn't help myself. I crept quite close as I had watched the little scene play out. So I was only a few paces from the man, although hidden behind a large cluster of birch trees. I'm sure it was a very unsettling experience for the hiker and his companion. Suddenly the dog was the picture of obedience again and shot straight to the man's heel. The man was already looking panicked and was scanning the trees where I was hidden. I'm not sure if he saw me, but they quickly retreated the way they came. I did not follow them. I did not wish to cause the man more stress and fear. I do hope he didn't suffer any lasting effects from the experience. I keep waiting to hear his account from the stories that Nance has collected. I know it's a long shot, but still, I would like to know what the poor man thought of that encounter. But I'm off the topic again. Sorry. So anyway, that is how Bad Dog got his name. And having him mull with me on that branch, well, that suddenly made me think I might just live through that situation. We just sat there for a bit. We aren't a race that uses words needlessly. What was there to say? For the moment, being together was enough. Finally, we started to make our plans. I had to get River to safety, and that meant finding my father's tribe. I had been there the summer before. I was pretty sure I could find the way. Mole and Dog were going to help me get my sister to safety, but then they hesitated. They were both of an age that they would not be welcome into a new tribe. Not unless they found a mate there, which was unlikely given how young they were. They would have left our own tribe in one or two more summers to set out on their own to find mates. Then they would live with their mate's tribe. But they were too young and too inexperienced to be seriously considered as suitors yet. But they were old enough to be seen as unfit to be around the females of the tribe. See, it was different for me. I was direct family. It wasn't unheard of to live with one's father's tribe. But that's as far as it went, and I knew it. Mole and Dog would be tolerated because they helped River and I, but they would not be welcome to stay for long. Mole seemed a bit wistful, but Dog was ever the adventurist. He figured he would set out to the far north, the place our ancestors come from. We know our kind is still there. Sometimes one from our area will go up and then come back, or one of the northerners will find their way down to us here. It happened a lot more in my grandfather's time, but we do still have the occasional wanderer to bring us news. Dog thought it was time to go find the great wild space that is supposed to exist. We know it's cold, colder than we've ever experienced. But those men, those soldiers, well, they were going to keep coming. It was time for a fresh start, hopefully far from the reach of men. Mole didn't have a better idea and thought he might as well go too, although I knew he would have preferred to stay with me. But first, we had to get my baby sister to safety. The rest could be sorted out later. I had my two closest friends with me, and together everything seemed so much easier. We could face any danger. Just on cue, it seemed we started to hear voices in the woods. There were three of the men that murdered our family about to walk right underneath us. They seemed to be looking for any stragglers, although they did not seem pleased at being separated from the main group and their large machines. It was just then that River started to key into the fact that suddenly things had become tense and fearful. She objected to the shift in mood, loudly. Just as the soldiers whipped their eyes upwards, Mole and Dog were gone. A small nod from Mole, a gesture that held all our summers of friendship, and all the things that did not need to be said. Then I felt an encouraging clap on the back from Dog. And that was all there was time for, before they had dropped out of the branches. I knew what they were doing. It was about protecting River. They couldn't allow her to be captured, and I couldn't fight without putting her in direct danger. My two best friends expected me to run. They knew I would. They knew I had to. And they knew that for me, it would be equal to the sacrifice that they were making. I was being kept back from the fighting once again, as my two best friends were flying right into the face of our enemies. They knew it would be terrible for me. We didn't need to discuss it, even if there had been time. I would run because it is what had to be done, just like they were doing what had to be done too. Before the men knew what was happening, Mole had dropped two of them while Dog drew their fire. The last man realized the trap just in time to whirl around, and he shot Mole point blank in the chest, and Mole dropped to the ground. The shooter swiveled wildly, looking for the next target, and he started to swing the point of his gun into the trees. By this point, the gunfire had brought more soldiers. They were shouting and starting to panic as the first man pointed to the branches. There was a deep war cry, half growl, half scream, and it seemed to go on forever. Dog had made sure all eyes were on him before he ran, and they gave chase. For a moment, I thought he was injured. He was moving so slow and clumsy, until I saw him glance back over his shoulder with a smile and a wink. Yeah, that was Dog. He was never so lost in a bad situation that he couldn't take joy in the moment. And in that moment, he was taking pleasure in toying with his opponents. He meant for those men to see him. He wanted all attention on him, so I could slip away with River, even if she was squalling like a trapped catamount, which she still was. I watched as Dog skillfully darted through the trees. He made sure the men would catch a glimpse of him, ensuring that every soldier was focused on giving chase. I could see his intent was to lead them as far in the opposite direction as he could get them to go. Knowing Dog, I thought he might very well get them to run after him all the way into the wild north. That's the last time I saw my best friends. I have no hope that Mole survived. It's true, not all of your guns will kill us. Well, not instantly, at least. But we are flesh and blood, and we cannot survive our chest being ripped open. Even if I hadn't seen the wound myself, I would have heard some word of him by now. Mole liked the comfort of familiar ground. He would have tried to seek me out, and likely would have succeeded. I knew he had gone back to Mother Earth the minute it happened. But Bad Dog, well, now that's a different story. I always did have hope that he made it to the Wild North. And if anyone could do it, he could. I like to believe that he did make it out, but thought that I would never know for sure. I had no word of him, but I fancied that was because he had made it to the great northern wilderness. I imagined him happily being kept warm by his mate as he watched his family grow in a place so wild no humans ever went there. If anyone could make it, it was Dog. But I figured I would never know for sure. That is, until I met Nance. She told us a story about a man that was minding his own business in the woods when suddenly a Sasquatch ran by, and he's being attacked by a pack of wolves. The man described how the pack set on the Sasquatch as he ran, never stopping as he tossed the wolves aside, and he hit them with a club that he was swinging as they jumped on his back and snapped at his heels. I knew right then that had to be Dog. Did I stress how badly a Sasquatch has to provoke a pack of wolves to have them full-on attack a grown male Sasquatch? I've only heard of one in all of my many winters, and that would be Dog. I couldn't believe it. I know in these old bones, that was him. Nance has helped give many of us hope. The stories are like hearing news of long-lost family as we get clues in the encounters that humans tell about when they happen upon us. I have gained a lot of bits and pieces from the stories that Nance recounts for us. It's been an invaluable source of information. We have even solved an old family mystery. But that's another story. So please, send your stories in to Nance. You would be surprised. What seems like a small detail to you, well, that just might be the big missing piece of a puzzle to us. I have gone on long enough. The Sasquad, they're so good at listening, I just can't seem to help myself. I hope you all enjoyed my ramblings about my old friends. Thank you for listening. Keep up the good work, Nance. I'll look forward to your next visit and the stories you bring. Signed, Rocky. All right, Sasquatch. Well, I do hope that you liked Rocky's story, because I did. And I hope that Rocky sends in a lot of those stories that he hinted at. When I do know that something is fiction, by the way, I will always tell you. And I don't normally do any fiction on this channel other than at Halloween. But I really liked these stories. And that first story, if you haven't heard it, it will blow you away. It is so detailed, and you get so involved at the Sasquatches being hunted down by these soldiers. It just breaks your heart. I would highly recommend you make sure you click on that link if you have not heard that story yet. So I'm going to put that link in the video description below, and I'm going to make it one of the clickable rectangles at the end of this video. I'll make sure it's the only one. And the clickable rectangle, I think the thumbnail for it says, "Entire Sasquatch Tribe Massacred." I think that's what it says. I'll have to look at it again. But it's a really good one. You definitely want to hear it if you haven't already. Now listen, a couple things I didn't mention. I have a lot of chit-chat, and I'm sorry, you can tell my voice has been fading. I've done a ton of recording lately for other things, not just for this channel. I'll get into that one of these other days. But one of the things I wanted to mention was the overwhelmingly positive response to the fictional stories, especially these from like Ophelia, and some of them from Halloween. Well, it's got me to thinking, well, maybe I should just do a second channel of just fictional stories of all kinds of cryptids and paranormal. Yeah, I mean, what do you say? I mean, the thing is, first, I need to get a bunch of stories to get it started, just like I had to do for Buckeye Bigfoot. So if you've got a good story, a fictional story out there brewing in your head, type it out and send it in to me. For now, just send it to contact at Buckeye Bigfoot. Just be sure to tell me it's fiction. If I can get enough stories together in the next month or two, enough to launch another channel, well, I'll get it set up and get it rolling. And then you guys will have even more to listen to. All right. Well, listen, I really did enjoy these stories. I hope you did too. I've just decided all of this about a second channel right here and now. So, you know, what can I say? That's just how I roll sometimes. All right. Now, listen, this weekend is the Smoky Mountain Bigfoot Conference in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. And y'all, I have to show you some of the things that I've been making to sell at this convention. I have got to get a website up and running to sell some of this stuff. You know, I mean, I was literally just this past week, I was just showing someone some of the little garden flags that I made. We were talking about how to sublimate things. So I was telling her the process and I showed her how they came out. She flipped out. She's not even a Sasquatch fan, but she bought both designs off of me right then. Then she called me a few hours later after her daughter saw them and her daughter wanted one of those designs. So apparently they're okay. So here you go. Here's a look at a couple things I'm doing. First up, I'm going to just throw up a couple mugs I'm doing. Here's some front and back ones. These are larger 15-ounce mugs. I don't know what I'm going to sell these for yet. I haven't done my price points. Don't ask. But there's a few of mugs. I know a lot of people like the Starry Night one. My favorite one is the one I call Whoop Whoop. It's the one with the little baby Bigfoot on one side, and on the other side it says Soft Squatch, Warm Squatch, Hairy Forest Brute. And I know we're all singing the song in our head, but that is absolutely, I think, just one of the really, really adorable ones. And then, sorry, I'm trying to look through the pictures here while I'm recording. And so those are the mugs. And here's a couple of the stainless steel tumblers. Like I've got this one, it's got a big eyeball hidden and it says Believe. And I've got like the Starry Night one. And I really like the Aurora Borealis one where he's standing on a mountain looking out. I've got some that look like stained glass. And, you know, that stained glass design is a big thing this year. And these next one, these little round things, those are ceramic ornaments. Now, I will be putting satin ribbon hangers on them and stuff, but I've got a bunch of different designs. So those are ceramic ornaments, and they're really, really nice. I think they're about 3 inches. And here are the two garden flags. I really like both of these. I just love all the floral around the one picture. That just looks so ridiculous. It's funny. So listen, you know, and what can I say? I'm sorry the pics aren't that great. I literally just ran downstairs to my She Cave quilting and crafting area, pulled out a few things and snapped some pictures with my phone. And this is not by any means all the merchandise by a long shot. It's just what I could grab real quick and take a picture real quick. Now, I'm just showing you some of these things because the last couple of years at conventions or right before, I kept saying, oh, I had all this new stuff at convention. And I would promise everyone I would share it with you and show you. And I never did. And the reason is because I sold most of my stuff almost all the way out. And a lot of it, I just couldn't order again because it wasn't available. So I'm showing these things to you now because these are things that I'm making. And I have already confirmed through large producers that I can get the blanks to make all these items in bulk without problem. So if you want something, I can make it for you. Now, I'm thinking about doing some personalized mugs and all kinds of stuff, but we'll get there. The thing is, I've got to get through this convention. Then I got to get this Shopify thing up and running. And oh my God, I hate doing that stuff. I don't know. Maybe I'll hire out somebody to do my websites for me. I really, really hate doing all that. So anyway, now you guys have a little bit of a look. I'm going to still try to get a marathon ready through this Friday. I'm sorry I'm so chatty tonight. I had a lot I wanted to say. This was a really, really long story. I think we're at like 40, 45 minutes already. So yeah, it's been a good day, busy day. So listen, what can I say? I think I've said it all. So listen, everybody, thanks for being a good sport. Again, if you've got some fiction you want to send in or you know somebody who's good at writing fiction, please make it the cryptid, the paranormal slant, something really cool. I don't care if it's ghosts. I don't care. Just something cool. Send it in. Let's get another channel rolling because I would love to talk to y'all more than once or twice a week. All right. So listen, until we meet up again, I want you to always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, folks. Have a good day.